If you were here last Sunday, you will recall that we considered how Jesus redefined greatness for us. Jesus said that greatness was equal to serving. At the time, we were studying the 20th chapter of Matthew's Gospel, and you may remember that we told the story of James and John's mother asking Jesus for a special place of honor for her sons in Jesus' kingdom. Jesus then took that opportunity to redefine greatness for his disciples. He said, "Whoever among you wants to be great must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." So according to Jesus, achieving greatness happens by being a servant. We are called to serve. Being a fully devoted follower of Jesus Christ means being fully devoted to being a servant, fully devoted to serving others. Now, as we reviewed last week's text last week, we mentioned some of the nuances of the text. For example, remember how shocked I was. You maybe didn't realize this or weren't as impressed with this as I was, but I had never realized before that when the sons of Zebedee's mother approached Jesus on their behalf, she took them with them. They were there. I think that was embarrassing. You may remember that the other disciples, the 10, as they were called in this passage, were indignant with the two brothers that they had asked for these preferential situations. You remember that Jesus said that the rulers of the Gentiles flaunt the authority that they possess over these people. But then Jesus said to his disciples, "I need you to be different. I want you to be different." And he used these words. He said, not so with you. But one of the things that we missed last week was a detail, but I think it's kind of an important detail, and I'm wondering if any of you happened to catch it. As we were planning last week's worship service, which actually goes back now almost 3 weeks, we happened to make mention of it in our planning session. So let me read this one passage of Scripture again to you, Matthew chapter 20, verse 20. "Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Jesus with her sons, and kneeling down, asked a favor of him." Did you get it? This woman, this mother, doesn't have a name. Now, of course, she has a name. We just don't know what it is. We know that she must have had a life before she was married, before she married Zebedee and gave birth to his sons. When she was born, she was probably carrying a name like Mary or Elizabeth or Chloe or Ruth or Hannah or Esther or Dorcas or any one of a number of names. But when she married, she gave up her identity, or it was taken away from her. Now, in the interest of efficiency and perhaps saving ink as we publish the Bible, the biblical authors could have said, if her name was Ruth, for example, "Ruth brought her sons to Jesus and asked a favor." But instead, they say, "Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Jesus with her sons and asked a favor of him." Now I know, and you know, that in biblical times, the culture was dominated by males, and that history has been written by males. I know that women were second-class citizens, that they could not vote, that they could not testify in a court of law, and they were considered property in some specific situations. But this passage of Scripture is interesting to me because it appears to go out of its way to make sure that her name does not get mentioned, like it's a secret or something. She is the mother of James and John. She is the one who carried each of those boys close to her heart for 9 long months, not to mention if she had other children, which she probably did. She was the one who cared for them, the one who nursed them, the one who bathed them, the one who dressed them, the one who cared for them, held them when they were sick. She would have played with them, taught them, disciplined them, and made sure that they were safe all the time. Those are responsibilities usually performed by the mother in this culture where this scripture is set. And the best part of it is, she did a pretty good job, right? I mean, her two sons became two of the 12 disciples. I mean, that's the all-star team. That's the Hall of Fame among Christianity. There are churches all over the world that are named after her two sons. Sure, we have St. James churches and we have St. John's churches, and that's who they're named after. That's the reference. In fact, her two sons became two of the three disciples who were the very closest to Jesus, right? Because every once in a while, Jesus would sneak off with the three, kind of like the executive team. It was Peter and James and John. Seems kind of unjust, right? That we don't know her name. Does it bother you the way it bothers me, or am I just making too much of nothing? I wonder if such a reference bothered her. Did she feel like she was being held down and oppressed, or did she simply take it in stride because that's how things were in those days? Did she perform her duties out of a sincere desire to serve God by serving others? Was she happy? Was she satisfied being willing and able to serve? Was she blessed by the fact that she models Christian behavior for all of us? In our scripture lesson for today, Paul writes to a group of Christians who together are known as the Philippian church. He says, "Make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose." Okay, what's he mean? He means he wants us to be like him, and he wants all of us to be like one another. He wants us to be unified in love and spirit and purpose. He says, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition and vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should not look only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross." As we continue to wrestle with Jesus' definition of greatness by closely linking it to service or serving, we also see that greatness is tied to humility. It is tied to selflessness, and it is tied to an extraordinary concern for others. And as I look around to see, could there possibly be an example that we could observe and imitate? I'm thinking that there could very well be a great example in our midst, and it is mothers. Mothers. You see, mothers show us how to love unconditionally. They show us how to care continuously. They show us how to give unceasingly. And they show us how to serve unselfishly. Think of it, okay? Think of it. Today is Mother's Day. How will you honor your mother today? First of all, if your mother is still living, then you are an especially blessed individual today, because you get to see her, or you get to talk to her, and you get to show her how much you appreciate her. There are people in the room whose mothers have gone on to receive their heavenly rewards, and they would give anything to have another conversation with their mother. You will give your mother a card that attempts to sum up your feelings about her, how much you love and appreciate her. Next, you will take her out for dinner, or you will make her dinner, right? Sure. Why would you do that? Well, because you want to be kind and thoughtful, and you don't want her to have to cook dinner on Mother's Day, right? Well, why is that? Well, it's because she's the one who cooks dinner every other day of the year. That's why. So then let's say that as soon as church is over today, you're going home. And you're going to say to your mother, or you're going to say to the mother of your children, I want this day to be special for you. I want this to be your day. Relax. Take a nap. Take the paper out onto the deck and sit in the sun. Get your sunglasses. Let me get you a glass of lemonade, and I'll make dinner, or we, the children and I, or the children themselves will make dinner. You do that. Here's something you need to know. Even though you've ushered her to the deck with lemonade and the paper, she won't relax and take it easy. She'll try, but she'll be thinking of all the things she should be doing instead of relaxing on the deck. That is, unless you've put something in the lemonade that you took out to her. She'll be sitting there saying, I should be doing laundry right now. Or I could be going through my clothing, or I could be cleaning out my bedroom, or I could be cleaning the basement. And she'll be wondering if you know what you're doing in her kitchen. And she'll be wondering, are you going to clean up? And when you say yes, you're going to clean up, she'll be wondering, what does that mean exactly? Does that mean you will place the dishes in the dishwasher? But will you also put all of the leftovers away? And will you clean the pots and pans? And will you put everything away that was on the dinner table? You know, like the margarine and the butter and the sugar and all that kind of stuff. And will you wipe off the placemats or wipe off the table or shake the tablecloth? And will you wipe off the counters where you prepared food? And will you wipe off the stove? And even will you wipe underneath the burners? And will you put the pots and pans away? Or will some of that await her when she's back on her feet? Now, maybe you will do it all, and I hope you do. She will worry about whether you will or not. And even if you do all of that to the very best of your ability, hear me now, folks, even if you do all of that to the very best of your ability, it won't be in the right place. And you won't have put things away the way she does. But you know that, right? You know that when you're not looking, or maybe even right in front of you, she's going to start moving things back to where they're supposed to be. Don't you just love that about her? Or let's say you have young children at home, and you say to your wife, honey, it's Mother's Day, you relax, I got this. I'll do everything. You won't have to lift a finger. Oh, well, you will need to nurse our son, Joey, because I can't do that for you. Wish I could, I can't, but I will do the meals, and I will do the diapers, and I will do baths and bedtime, I will do playtime, and I will referee all of the arguments, okay? Well, you might need to change Joey. It'd probably be better that you did that, because he's right there with you anyway, okay? By the way, where do we keep the aquifer? How do you turn on the oven? How long should I bake the potatoes? Don't get up, just tell me. Will the kids eat red beans and rice, or should I pick out all of the beans? Come on, will you please sit down, relax? Listen, it will drive your mother or it will drive your wife crazy to be waited on hand and foot. Why is that? Because she's not used to it. She's not used to it. No one ever waits on her hand and foot. It will drive her crazy if you assume full responsibility for dinner and total care for the children. But do it anyway. It's the thought that counts, and she will understand that you love her and that you appreciate her at least one day out of the year. But why is this so hard for her? It's because this is not normal. For her. Being served is not part of her normal operating procedure. You know why else it's hard? Because she is a servant. She is the one who serves. She loves to serve. She lives to serve and not to be served. I think I read that somewhere about Jesus, didn't I? Didn't he come to serve and not to be served? You see, friends, mothers model Jesus. They're not perfect. I get that. But they humble themselves. They consider the needs of others more than they consider their own needs. They care for others. Mothers want to serve. They live to serve, and they receive a blessing when they serve. Jesus did it, right? He served. Paul told us to do it, right? And while we, the rest of us, debate whether we should serve or not serve, and who it is we should serve and who we shouldn't serve, and to what degree we should serve and how much time we should serve, while we're debating all of that, mothers go ahead and do it. They just do it. They set an example for us. Now, some of you may say, well, that's really an unfair comparison. Of course, mothers are willing to serve, you say, because they love the people that they are serving. They're their families. They're their kids. They're their husbands. And that's true. But aren't we told somewhere that we are supposed to love people? All people? Didn't Jesus say, you shall love your neighbor as yourself? And if that's the case, and we love our neighbor as we love ourselves, then that should make it easier for us to serve them, right? Serving others may be the most difficult thing that Jesus asks us to do. I don't know, there's probably a list of 10 things. Whoever wants to be great must be a servant. It means that we should care more about others than we do ourselves. It means that we should think more about the needs of others and less about our own needs. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others. And that is what it's like to be fully devoted to Jesus. That's what it's like when you have the heart of a servant. And people who possess this kind of devotion, this kind of servant-heartedness, this devotion to selflessness, these people have transformed the world in which we live. And they have transformed the lives of many who live in the world. These people are the backbone of great churches and great movements of Christianity. They have created preschools and universities. They have created hospitals and children's homes. They have fed the hungry, and they continue to do so again and again. Wouldn't it be nice to be around someone who is such a servant? Someone who is so willing to serve all the time. Gosh, we could watch them and we could learn from them. We could take notes from them as they model serving others. You know, for most of us, that person was or is your mother. For many of us, that person is the mother of your children. We can learn from them. You can learn from her. Today is Mother's Day. Honor your mother. Honor the mother of your children. And pay attention to her passion for serving.